manipulation of the electromagnetic spectrum via fields projected from human hands. We have a study here from 2004 by Randall L. Wetcher, MA, and Lauren Sergio, PhD, and this is exploring the question of, can humans project energy from their hands into the electromagnetic environment and make change? And what this study found is that they can, but they have to be willfully projecting that energy from their hands. If they just held their hands over the copper coils that they were measuring the electromagnetic environment, it wasn't enough. The practitioners actually had to willfully project the energy from their hands. It says right here, increasing evidence suggests that the Eastern concept of chi and the Western concept of bioelectromagnetic energy may be one and the same. So we can measure that. They used measurements such as hertz and frequency, and they were able to sense a change in the electromagnetic environment. There's some other interesting things in this article. It is also important to note that the magnetic field produced by the flow of current through a conductor, whether physical or biological, extends to infinite distance. The fields, much like circles of sound waves that become larger with distance as they move through space, become weaker in strength as they travel, but theoretically never end. Another doctor, Dr. Harold, calls these the fields of life. All electrical currents then include those arriving from living organisms are accompanied by magnetic fields that extend and interact throughout space. Every living organism is born, lives, and dies in a sea of electromagnetic radiation, and all life has evolved in an environment consisting of electromagnetic energy. As a result, the interactions that take place between all living organisms and electromagnetic energy are both crucial to life and are extremely complex. To deny interactions between electromagnetic fields and the living things would be to deny the fundamental reaction upon which every living thing on the planet depends, namely, the absorption of sunlight by green plants. What they're basically saying here is that there are interactions between living things and electromagnetic fields because sunlight is an electromagnetic field that green plants, that all plants that are green, that's an interesting thing because plants that aren't green, some of them don't use sunlight. So green plants are using a process of photosynthesis to definitely break down carbon dioxide and build the cellulose and the energy that becomes the tree and the fruit. The way that that happens is amazing. So it talks a little bit here about how there's technological advances that are explaining the biophysical connections that enable human beings, therapists, practitioners, martial artists to sense and manipulate the bioelectromagnetic energy fields produced by their bodies and then be able to influence another person's bioelectromagnetic energy fields. So somebody like a therapist is doing it to facilitate harmony, whereas somebody like a martial artist is projecting their bioelectromagnetic energy into a target to disrupt their bioelectromagnetic energy. It's a very long word to say. In the East, it's called chi. Now, this property of wholeness is amazing because there are parts of us, right? Like we have a leg bone is connected to the hip bone, but it's all one, right? And this electromagnetic current of energy that flows through us facilitates that oneness. It originates an ability. If we can see that, then we can see the ability of our wholeness. And if we can sense this energy, we can sense the harmony or the health of our entire body, because there will be signatures of disruptions anywhere we look in the energy field. This interaction refers to the property of wholeness, the integration that enables the parts to work together as a successful unit. The concept of wholeness or oneness has been generally disregarded in Western medicine and scientific inquiry in the past, but it is an integral component of Eastern medicine, philosophy, and scientific thought. In the East, the oneness that is crucial to the process of life is referred to as qi energy. And this energy is not just flowing through our body, it's flowing through the environment, it's flowing through other bodies. And this oneness doesn't just integrate ourself, but it integrates us into our environment. And us being from the skin in begins to disintegrate within this standpoint, because this chi energy comes in and out of us, which means that this life force isn't just contained within our physical unit. According to traditional Chinese medicine, chi is life, and the absence of chi is death. To be truly alive and maximally healthy is to have chi in every part of the body and flowing through and beyond the body. To die is to be a body without qi. For health to be maintained, there must be a balance of qi, neither too much nor too little. The sources of qi energy include nutritional qi, air qi, and original qi. Original qi is that portion of qi energy that is inherent to us and was transmitted to us at conception from our parents. It cannot be replenished, and it is thought to slowly diminish in intensity over the course of our lives. Original qi is the basic pattern of our being, and as such is critical to life. Upon death, this form of qi energy, like nutritional and air qi, ceases to flow through the body. And then it talks about how Harold Saxton Burr, an anatomist at the Yale School of Medicine, proposed that human beings, and in fact all forms of life, are ordered and controlled by electromagnetic field. It sounds a lot like qi, right? He called them, this is the same person that called them fields of life, are invisible and intangible, and it is hard to visualize them. But a crude analogy may, I like when the scientists start to admit that the words that they use are crude and the experiments that they use are crude, and that the actual concepts that we're trying to study in a reductionist way, where we try to reduce everything into a single unit that can be experimented with, when they actually admit that it is crude. My definition of that is that it is laughable. It's a laughable representation of reality when we're cutting things into pieces and then testing these pieces outside of their natural state. For instance, every single study is unnatural. It takes place indoors. It takes place around electromagnetic fields from our computers and our devices. It takes place within an environment that has fake artificial light, away from the wind, away from the natural air of the environment. Sometimes the pressure is different, and we've got scientists, doctors, observers witnessing and willing their agenda onto the experiments. This is not a way to study the holistic wholeness of anything on this planet, which is why some of us are skeptical of what we label as science. back to the fields of life, or L fields, life fields, I'm assuming that's what that means, are invisible and intangible, and it is hard to visualize them, but a crude analogy may help to show what the field of life do and why they are so important. Most people who have taken high school science will remember that if the iron filings are scattered on a card held over a magnet, they will arrange themselves in the pattern of lines of force of the magnetic field. Remember those lines that go out from the poles of the magnets? And if the filings are thrown away and fresh ones scattered on the card, the new filings will assume the same pattern as the old, which means that no matter which filings are thrown down, that field exists emanating off of the magnet, out of the magnet, through the magnet. So he's talking about the fields of life here, and he says something like this: though infinitely more complicated, happens in the human body. Sure does, because every cell, every component, everything has this. And the heart is definitely the resonator of it all. So here we go. I think they start talking about the heart, maybe not. Using sensitive magnetometers, scientists have measured the magnetic signature produced by the human heart, there we go, at a distance of up to 15 feet in front of the body, resulting in a blurry distinction between the organism and its environment. Blurry distinction. We are not just our body. There is much of us that is emanating out beyond our skin. Simultaneously, the organs and tissues that compose the human body interact with the electromagnetic fields in the environment. For example, it is known that brainwaves can be entrained by a widely cited phenomenon called the Schumann resonance. Now, this article goes into what the Schumann resonance is, and it also starts talking about how the brain goes into a silent phase. So check this out. So it talks about the Schumann resonance, and it starts talking about what that is, and it's the interaction between the ionosphere and how that moves, and how it's daytime and it's nighttime, and it starts to shift, and how it is in sync with the patterns that our brain goes through. And then this is really interesting. As a result of physiological constraints with the movement of calcium ions across the membrane of a neuron, these pacemaking thalamocortical, getting mixed up here because it's on two lines. Thalamocortical neurons experience a silent phase every 1.5 to 28 seconds. So the thalamus, the neurons in the thalamus area are experiencing a silent phase. Thalamus cortex, thalamocortical. So the cortex is, anyways, I just had a little link there. So every 1.5 to 28 seconds, okay, so there's silent phases, and they last from 5 to 25 seconds. And it is said that the brain waves are said to be in a free run period and are susceptible to entrainment with outside fields. So this is basically saying that there's moments in our brain that happen very often where we are susceptible to entrainment with external fields of energy, primarily the Schumann resonance. But this doesn't go into like the radio frequencies that are all around us and the electromagnetic frequencies coming off of our devices. But the point is, it gets back to the Qigong masters, and they have an ability to absorb qi from the environment and manipulate qi at will. They can project qi and influence living things as well as inanimate objects. So then he talked about traditional Chinese medicine and how disturbances in the electromagnetic energies are essentially what causes dis-ease. Because this is flowing throughout every part of our body. And the acupuncture meridians are actually low resistance pathways for the flow of electromagnetic information through the living matrix. So the acupuncture meridians are electromagnetic signals like the Chinese concept of qi energy, and they enter every organ, tissue, and cell of the body through the intracellular matrix between cells and cytoskeleton within cells. The meridians are simply the main channels or transmission lines in the continuous molecular fabric of the body. Some of these channels pass closer to certain organs within the body, ultimately relaying the strongest parts of any signal traveling along that meridian to the corresponding organ. In this way, the Chinese are able to influence the health of specific organs by manipulating the flow of qi energy along specific meridians. If you ever go to a chiropractor, you're doing this. If you ever go to an acupuncture, if you ever go to a reflexologist, even bodywork people, shiatsu especially, but many bodywork people are working with this energetic flow. For almost 5,000 years, the Chinese have known that encouraging the flow of qi energy through the body could stimulate healing of broken bones, soft tissue damage, help to cure disease, prolong life, and prevent illness. I have personally seen with my eyes somebody's bone snap, and within about an hour, it wasn't snapped. Person went into complete meditation, and I witnessed his leg not broken. I heard it break. So, despite abundant theoretical evidence supporting bioelectromagnetic energy as the Western scientific correlate of qi energy, very few rigorously controlled scientific studies have examined this relationship. This study is not rigorous. I believe there is only 3 participants. However, they were able to, and the participants were experts. They were able to change the fields of energy within the coils. There were some weaknesses in the study as well, but this was essentially just an experiment to explore whether it was possible or not, and to open the door for other experiments that are more subjects, more strict parameters to be done, based on the fact that there is definitely something here. I'm wondering, though, if there's any benefit to the people funding the experiments or to the institutions that are allowing these articles to be published and the professors that are allowing the students and the faculty to both graduate and work. If there is motivation to allow this to be measured and discussed, because this pretty much upsets everything that we do here in hospitals, in universities, and I would go even so far into sports and just life in general. This will be a significant change if we as a culture accept this and realize that, number one, we've been ignoring it, so we're behind in the game. We have to admit our ignorance and then seek guidance from others who have not been ignorant and were able to be open. And for For a lot of us, that means other parts of the world that have been demonized through religions, through media, through cultural programming. And that's a lot of changing. And we don't need anybody's permission to do it. We can take this study. We can practice on our own. I've got kriyas, I think 114 of them. Conveniently in 15 to, they're around 12 to 25 minute sessions where you can actually feel this flow of energy going through the body. And you can have an experience on your own, away from these words and this nonsense of these studies that are laughable at proving what is always been. Let me know if you have any questions.